de Cognitalk qui va présenter Rémi.
Bonsoir. Okay. I didn't quite listen to what you were saying, so hopefully I don't repeat what you just said. So I think we have a great program tonight. We have two things that we're going to go on.
Je vais juste dire que nos invités sont italiens, donc ils vont parler anglais parce qu'on pensait que c'est mieux que l'italien. Donc voilà.
Yeah, I wanted to say that. So it's going to be in English tonight. Hopefully you're fine with that. So we have two things going on tonight. In the first part, about 15 minutes or 20 minutes, we have Rémi with us. Can we project to the screen? Rémi Coulom is the author of CrazyStone, which is a software that's playing Go. So it's an artificial intelligence software that's playing Go, and until very recently, it's been the best Go playing program in the world. So Rémi has given a talk in Nantes in December, last December. We were very, very happy to have him here, and it was a lot of fun. And you probably, or at least some of you, have seen that recently there was a lot of things going on in the game of Go. There is an American company called Google who has a branch in London, and they have worked on Go, and they have put out a very interesting piece of software as well, and that has beaten very recently the European Go Master, and which next week on the 9th will start a championship with one of the best Go playing humans on this planet, which is Lisa Dahl. And so it's one of these turning points in the history of AI where we see whether machines can actually surpass humans. We've seen that in 97 with Kasparov, who played Deep Blue from IBM and who lost. So maybe we're going to see something else on the Go side of things in the next week. So it's a very challenging and a very interesting point in time in the history of artificial intelligence. And Rémi was playing a very important role over the last years, not only as the holder of the best program, but also of being very instrumental in that community and of participating in many competitions and things like that. So. Bonsoir, Rémi.
Bonsoir.
I don't know whether you want to talk English or French. I think both are fine. We have two people here in the room who definitely don't speak French. So
I can speak English.
Okay, so if you want to do this in English, that would be great. So maybe you can comment a little bit of what's going on, your personal perspective on this, and what you think is going to happen next week, and so on and so forth. I leave it up to you. Like 15 minutes or so would be great. Thanks.
Yeah, so when the Nature paper was published, I was surprised. In fact, I was especially surprised since the programmer of AlphaGo is my former student, and he did not tell me anything about what was going on. And so when I visited you in Nantes a few months ago, I concluded my talk by saying that deep learning was a promising research direction, and it turned out I was right, but unfortunately I'm a bit late behind them. And so, yes, what can I say? So, yes, next week they will play a match. So I believe if they play the match, it's because they expect that they have good chance to win. It's difficult to predict. I hope that they will lose, but unfortunately, it's likely they will win in my opinion, but we will see. And So since the published the paper in Nature, I'm working very hard to improve CrazyStone. I was already working on deep learning a few months ago, but now everybody is working very hard on deep learning. So in 2 weeks, I will go to Japan for the UEC Cup, and it will be a big tournament with all the computer Go people, well, except Google, unfortunately, but yeah, we are not strong enough for them. And so Facebook would participate in these tournaments, so it would be a nice event. Yes, and so yeah, it would be very exciting to talk about all the other co-programmers. And yes, I don't know what else to say. Do you have questions?
Maybe you can comment on why Go is so difficult for computer programs. And I mean, as you just said, in December you predicted that it will take still quite some time until a computer can actually beat one of the grandmasters in Go. Why do you think this is evolving so fast now? What is happening actually?
What's happening is that deep learning is surprisingly successful, and it's really shocking how well it works. And yes, and so in the beginning I underestimated deep learning a lot because I had my own pattern learning system, and yes. It turned out, yes, deep learning, so you have to use a very big network and train it for very long. I think that's one of the big keys of the success of Google, is they have huge computational power. And so if you use a small network and train it for a small period of time, it will not be very strong. But if you have a very big network and train it with 50 GPUs for 2 months or something like this, then it can, become very strong. So I think, yes, most of us, well, we knew that deep learning was promising, but we did not expect it would be that effective. Yeah.
Okay, so I understand that this came as a surprise. I mean, I think we were all surprised. I remember our discussions last year, and actually while we discussed, they had already performed that competition against the European grandmaster, and so they already knew, we didn't. If you look at this, I mean, I know that you are actively working on implementing your own version of deep learning. How important do you think is to train the neural networks on supervised data? So, you know, taking existing games that were recorded, and then you present the data to the network and have it learn that, versus, which is Demis Hazabi is very much insisting on that, versus self-playing neural networks. So the neural network trained initially and then it plays against itself, becoming better all the time. Any idea of how important that is?
Sorry, I did not understand the question.
The question is, you know, how important is self-learning or self-playing? So they initially train the neural network on some existing games, and once it's bootstrapped that way, and then they continue to train the neural network, but the neural network plays against itself.
Yes.
And then they apply reinforcement learning. Any comment on that?
I did not understand. I understood everything except the question.
Whether you have any comment on this?
Comments? Yes. So that's, I think the really big originality of their paper is the fact that they train a value network. Because in the past, we use machine learning in Go, but only to learn a policy. That's to say, a distribution probability of all legal moves that we use to shape the search tree or to choose moves in the random playouts. And what they did, and what is very original, well, it's not so very original, because in the 90s there was a lot of research about using neural network to learn a value function for the game of Go. There was in particular a program called NeuroGo by Marcus Enzenberger that was successful at that time, but they were using extremely small neural network and they trained it with little data, and it was very weak. And I think, yes, that's the most, I think the most exciting idea in their paper is that they actually managed to learn a value function. That is to say, take a board as input and give as output, not a move, but an evaluation of the position. And yes, and that's a really interesting novelty compared to what we were doing with Monte Carlo research.
Right.
And, And something that really shocked me in this paper is that even without Monte Carlo search, that is to say, if they use the grow tree and just evaluate the leaves of the tree with their value network without running random playouts to the end of the game, they still manage to have a very strong program. And that's really surprised me. Yeah.
Okay. Any other comments that you would like to make? You know, how impactful this is, what's going on, you know, on the rest of game AI. I mean, you are not only programming Go, but you're also involved in chess and other games.
Turning point? So I think Go is really the perfect match for deep learning because it's a matter of pattern recognition. And so we have a board as input, a board as output. And of course, similar techniques can be applied to chess. Well, recently there were some paper published about applying deep learning to chess, but it's not so successful. The really particular aspect of Go is that convolutions really make sense in Go because this neighborhood around every stone is very significant. And for games of chess, the convolution makes much less sense, so it's more difficult. But there are other games that look a bit like Go, but are not very well known, like the game of Hex. And I'm quite sure that the techniques that work for the game of Go will work for the game of Hex. I don't know if you know it, but it's not very well known. And yes, so outside Go, I don't know.
Okay.
But it's like, you know, deep learning is so powerful. It's killing every problem everywhere. It will kill more problems for sure.
Yeah. Okay. I have two more for you, two more questions. The first is, will we see in the near or distant future, will we see a competition of any sort where CrazyStone plays against AlphaGo?
I don't know. Yeah. So there is this UC Cup, but they are not participating. So I don't know. But it will not be very interesting. You know, right now, they would crush CrazyStone very easily. In their paper, they won, I don't know how many, 500 games to zero or something. I don't remember the numbers.
Yeah, but you're working on it and you're improving it.
Yeah.
No pressure here.
I've been working very hard in the last month and I'm making good progress, but I cannot compete with their hardware. And yes, my progress is, so I decided to develop my own homemade deep learning library. So it took me a lot of time. It's maybe a bit bold decision, but I'm really happy with this because I'm learning a lot with GPU programming and everything. Mm-hmm. And so I've just started to work recently and I'm really excited by the performance of what I get. And so I think it will take me maybe a few months to become very strong. Yeah.
Okay. Well, thanks for that. And we are looking forward. I mean, we were kind of proud to have the holder of the, the strongest Go playing software here in France. And we would like to win that back. So our thoughts are with you. My last question is, like everybody else, if you look on the web, there are lots of websites that try to make predictions or ask people to give their opinion on who's going to win next week. What's your score or what's your thought on this? Who's going to win?
Who's going to win? If I had to bet my money, I would say Google will win.
Okay, so yeah. I looked at some of those websites that are actually trying to collect opinions, and it's pretty much 50-50 right now. Some websites are 60-40, but
this is a tricky question.
It's we don't know. I mean, actually, Lisa Dahl was asked what he thinks, and he said that he is pretty confident that he will win. So we'll see what's going on next week. Yeah. Okay, are there any other questions here in the audience? Okay. Thanks, Rémi. Thanks for being with us.
Thank you. Goodbye.
So wait, Rémi, before you go, this is Jeff talking. How, just to get an idea of what advantage Google and Facebook have in this, how much would it cost you to, so the hardware that they use, you can probably rent on AWS or something like that. How much would it cost you to do this if you were just money?
A lot. So I'm already spending quite a lot of money these days on Amazon servers, and I don't know. I don't want to estimate, because in the paper they describe the experiment that works. But in order to produce something that works, you have to try hundreds of things that don't work. And I expect that the amount of computation they use to produce AlphaGo is worth around $1 million. It's not affordable for me. Yeah. I have to use clever algorithms instead. Yeah.
Right. Good. Thanks.
Sorry, I cannot hear anything.
Okay, I think. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. I think we have a connection. We just had a connection problem. Thanks, Rémi, for being with us tonight. It was
Thank
great.
You.
Thank you. I will connect soon by email again and let you go. Thank you. Bye.
Bye,
bye for tonight. Bye. Okay, so glad that this Skype did actually work out. That's not always obvious. Alrighty. So that was the first part, and I think it was kind of fun to hear Rémi talk about the reality after a few months that he had talked to us about the future, because the future came much faster than anybody expected, so that's kind of fun. The second part tonight is, as Jeff had introduced, is kind of different. It's not about games, but it's very game-like, and it's my pleasure to introduce Marco Gori. Marco is a professor at the University of Siena in computer science. He is a person that has been very long in the machine learning, AI, game AI as well, community. He has a very long track record of very interesting things that he has done. And tonight he will talk to us about learning with and from constraints. So I have had the immense pleasure over the last year to have discussions with him on this topic at various occasions, and I found it very fascinating. So I'm very happy to share this with the non-meetup community tonight. Before I let Marco do his presentation, I just want to thank the people from APTech here again. That was it's a wonderful opportunity. It's a great room here. Thanks for having us, and thanks for the professional equipment and services. And I also want to thank Jeff, who usually doesn't get thanked because he's the one who presents. So now that I'm presenting, thanks, Jeff, for putting all this together. I know it's much more work than it looks like. Thanks. Okay, without any further ado, Marco Gori on learning with and from constraints.
Okay, so of course, thanks a lot for inviting me, for giving a talk here in Nantes. Of course, it's a nice opportunity of exchanging ideas, and especially I would like also at the end of the talk, if you are curious and you want to make questions, I'm really very happy. So it's interesting, before starting to present my talk, we have seen in the previous discussion the importance of machine learning. Everybody now is so happy with deep learning, this magic word. And I have to tell you that sometimes I'm really a little bit embarrassed in seeing, you know, the outcome of deep learning, you know, the way the impact that we have seen in a number of different problems, in a number of different contexts. I'm a little bit embarrassed because I've seen this this stuff many years ago. I had the opportunity and the pleasure to start studying machine learning exactly at the time in which one of the the leader nowadays in the field, one of the people who has contributed more to promote deep learning, Joshua Benjo, you know, was we are doing essentially the PhD at the same time in McGill. Many years ago, and I have the pleasure of discussing with Joshua more or less a couple of years ago, and I'm really excited about, you know, this big impact. And of course, it's something concrete, and but of course, there is something that I'd like to pose to your attention tonight when talking about machine learning and all the challenging application. It has to do with, you know, where is the value of this kind of technologies, especially deep learning, whether, you know, the value is on something which is concretely new from, you know, a computational model, from the perspective of a computational model, or if on the opposite, you know, we are talking about very, very smart people who have been using in a very professional way computational resources that were not available many years ago. And of course, this is a very nice question, very important question, because the role of computational resources is definitely important, but maybe it's not the only reason. There are, you know, some important new things. And of course, it's not the subject of the discussion tonight, but this is just to tell you that what you see here and what I call learning from constraint is, you know, our approach to proposing learning in a, let's say, in a different way with respect to what we have been seeing at the moment. In a different way, because instead of talking about, you know, the architecture, the algorithms that are improving what we saw many years ago, backpropagation-like algorithms, I'm trying to do something which I think it's, you know, it's remarkably different. I want to see it's better because at the moment I have to honestly have to say that we have just you know, very preliminary results from an experimental point of view. And this is a field in which until you need to reach some important achievement from an experimental point of view if you want to have your idea really supported. And so it's preliminary, even if it is published, even if, you know, there is something that I think is already pretty well organized, it's preliminary in terms of impact. Anyway, I will do my best to convey at least a few ideas. So there are many slides, but I will focus just on few, just to convey the basic ideas. So I will talk about, you know, what to me, what are constraints, and what is the typical life of the intelligent agents I'm thinking about. I'm thinking about the environment, and I'm thinking about the life of those agents in their environment. And I'm proposing this notion of constraint, which is, of course, nothing new in artificial intelligence. It is a new, I would say, once you propose this kind of context. And the focus will be on learning. So what is the meaning of learning from constraints? We'll see that it's a sort of new protocol. You know for sure what is supervised learning, what is unsupervised learning, what is semi-supervised learning, reinforcement learning. It's something new with respect to this kind of classical framework. I will propose a few case studies, and then at the end, I will focus attention on what is, at the moment, which is capturing my attention, at least in the last couple of years. So what I write here, developmental learning, because it is what I like most. But in order to talk quickly at the end of my discussion of developmental learning, I decided to talk before of my efforts in discussing what you know, learning from constraint is. What is learning from constraint? Let me give you an example. This is classical supervised learning. So everybody here know that you may give some target and then you want to construct a function which gets as close as possible to a certain target. So this is supervised learning. You have to provide a lot of labeled data, but if you think in terms of, from a pure mathematical point of view, this is a function, right? And you are imposing a constraint, just a sort of pointwise constraint on this function. So it's just an example of course, of constraint. This is another example. You see, suppose you are given some rules. These are rules for medicine, okay? And they are essentially proposition, right? They are proposition because you say that, you know, typical rules that you may use for diagnosis. You have intervals of variables, and then you have constraints on the decisions, right? Well, you see different formalism, but are constraints. This is yet another example in which you propose constraints, right? Because you say, well, I want to recognize characters, but you see the difference between 8 and 3 is that there is a portion in which these two characters are really very different. So it could be interesting to express in a very, you know, in an explicit way this different. And think about, for example, documents and text categorization. Just consider this example here. You want to take a decision, right? You want to take a classification of a certain document. I suppose X is the representation of your document, just a keyword-based representation of your document. You want to classify the document, and you could say, for example, any document which deals with, suppose, neural network and numerical analysis, suppose this is the category numerical analysis, is a document dealing with machine learning, right? You see the implication. Anytime a document deals with neural networks and numerical analysis, then, you know, it's a machine learning paper. And any machine learning paper is an artificial intelligence paper, right? Well, of course, you are constraining your decision, right? Because you have still to take these decisions because you have to decide what C1, C2, C3, C4 are from your data, right? Just with a sort of learning process, but then you have constraints during the decision. Now, this is a completely different picture. This has to do with vision, but it's an example that I like because, you know, it's a very nice example of what, you know, a constraint means. So, for example, suppose you want to compute, this is a classical problem in computer vision, you want to calculate the optical flow, so the velocity of the pixels, right? So suppose I'm moving my finger now, right? Look at my nail, okay? So if you look at my nail, well, if you want to impose a constraint, you could say that the brightness of my nail doesn't change as you move the nail, okay? Well, this is a good approximation in this room. Of course, if I get close to this lamp, you know, things are changing a little bit, but it's a good approximation. So the brightness doesn't change. Well, from this condition that the brightness doesn't change, this is a classical equation which is derived in computer vision. It's a constraint at the end of the day for computing the velocity. And of course, there are so many examples that has to do with constraints. But of course, you have to determine to discover a language for unifying all those problems. And there is for sure a big problem, which is shown in this picture, when you want to talk about learning and relation and logic, and when, for example, the constraints has to do with logic, like the example I gave you on document classification. Because typically, you know, in artificial intelligence, we have two schools of thought. We are people, you know, who are very strong in formal logic, you know, who are, have a lot of background in knowledge representation, in formal, you know, in reasoning, in automatic reasoning. And then, you know, there are people with strong background in optimization and statistics, which typically, you know, are pushing toward machine learning. But the, those people typically don't communicate so much. And I think this is a problem. So let me give you, in this slide, I want to show you that maybe you are aware of somebody here in this room, maybe well aware of what t-norm are and you know their impact in fuzzy systems. But if you are not, please have a look at this slide because I think it's pretty important in order to understand you know how we can unify you know the discrete setting of computation. I mean, typical symbolic representation and real valued representation. So once again, take a logic formula like this, and you see a formula like this can be rewritten in using a real valued formula. So you see here you have logic variable A and B, and whenever the end of A and B is true, you know, you have the implication. So A and B imply C. Look at, you know, the corresponding formula, real valued formula. You see, whenever this value is close to 1 and this value is close to 1, can you guess when the constraint is verified? Pretty simple, you know. This is 0 if and only if FC is close to 1, right? So this is just delivering the principle of implication. If this is true and this is true, then also C is true, okay? But now you are playing with real numbers. And of course, there is a way for constructing this kind of formula. There is a very well-established theory. Roughly speaking, you know, if you take a formula like this, which is just equivalent to this one, right? You see what happened? There is a beautiful isomorphism. You take, for example, this operation, which is the end, and you replace the end with the product. Right, you see here, and then you take the knot and you replace the knot in this way, 1 minus. And then you impose, in order to say that this formula is true, you have to say that all this stuff is equal to 1. And then you end up in this equation, right? And this is nice because, you know, you can start from first order logic, for example, and you can rewrite the formula using real valued functions. Well, this is just a way of converting, you know, this formula. There are many other ways, but, you know, one is enough. So in this slide here, I'm just making a general picture of what a constraint could be. At the end of the day, you see, a constraint is just a function, you see, phi of task, f of x. Go back here, you see, you have this is an example of constraint. You see, you have some functions here. Look at the functions, f, a, b, and c. And then you have a formula. This is phi, what I denote by phi. This is the formula telling you that, you know, you are satisfying a certain constraint. So in order to express a sort of, you know, a knowledge about a certain problem, okay, you have a formula, and this formula is a constraint. And constraints, you may have many different kind of constraints. So, well, I don't want to be boring about this possibility, but, you know, this classification, this taxonomy. But essentially, you know, you have this kind of constraints, so they are functions, phi, which, you know, are simply expressing a certain rule. Roughly speaking. And of course, you may have even other notion of constraint. This is more, look at this, the difference between this kind of constraint and this kind of constraint. This is local, you know, it holds for any x, whereas here does involve directly the function f. It's a sort of, you know, global constraint. And then could be unilateral, or could be bilateral. You see, this is the meaning of bilateral, okay? And this is the meaning of unilateral. Okay, but regardless of this kind of taxonomy, well, you can actually find a number of different cases here. For example, here I call point-wise constraint. Those constraints where, you know, that are only defined on points. You see the difference? In principle, look at an equation like this. This is a constraint which holds for any x. Any x means any, supposing pattern recognition, means any pattern, right? Okay, so so what is learning from constraint, from given constraint? Oh, look at this. This is important. Learning from given constraint. I'm assuming that somebody is providing the constraint, which is, you know, sometimes is nice, but it's not always the case in many concrete problems. So there is a sort of different protocol with respect to learning, what we know about learning, because, you know, it's a matter of communication, right? You want somebody to learn, but the big difference with respect to nowadays popular scheme of machine learning is that we are asking the satisfaction of constraints, right? Okay, so look at the classical way we impose learning nowadays. Everybody here, I guess, know what supervised, unsupervised, semi-supervised learning is. Now, that's the new protocol, right? You're given an input here, okay? Suppose this is a document, a textual document, and this is its representation into the computer. You know probably the TF-IDF representation in information retrieval, the keyword-based representation in information retrieval. So given the input, given the document, you have a function, and this function performs classification, right? This could be a classification. And then you have a number of constraints on those tasks, okay? And so that's the big difference. The big difference here is that the protocol of communication with the learning agent is that somebody is offering constraints, right? I'm not providing a positive and negative example for supervision. I'm providing a collection of formula that are constraints on the problem, okay? Here is an example. Look at this. Suppose you want to make some classification. You may have some formula here. You see, these are formula. And this is the corresponding translation into real valued equations, right? So these are, this could be documents or even sentences, brief portion of a document, and you may be interested in classifying the content, right? And you see, these are functions that make predictions, okay? But you see, the big difference is that I'm not providing, in principle, only collection of examples for supervising what is a mammal, right? On what is an ungulate, or what is, black stripes, right? Or what is a zebra? Well, what I'm providing are formula which connect all those functions. So that's the big difference, right? Because somebody need to provide this information. And then you start to learn, but you have to learn coherently with this kind of constraints. So at the end of the day, it's still the same framework of machine learning, because you still need to develop function F, but the big difference is that the protocol of communication is different, because somebody is enforcing some constraints, okay? And these are example. So here, somebody knows some logic formula and is enforcing this kind of constraint. So if you look at this picture, you see that also what could be the basic idea for learning. So essentially, you are given two ingredients. One ingredient is the constraints. So somebody needs to provide this information, right? And the other ingredient is that you want to develop a solution. So you want to learn these functions here. You see, these are the functions that you want to learn. But you want to learn this function according to a sort of parsimony principle, a typical approach of machine learning. So you want to have, for example, smooth solutions. But you see, we can construct from the constraints penalty functions immediately. Because if you look at these functions, well, essentially, they are already penalties, because they are zero, right? Only provided that you discover the right solution. Otherwise, they are positive. So they are already penalty functions, just like the quadratic error in supervised learning, okay? Or the loss, the typical loss functions in supervised learning. So that's the basic idea. The new penalties, oh, sorry about that, yeah. The new penalties, okay, are just the penalties that arise because of the constraints, okay? So how can we, at the end of the day, invent a mechanism for learning? Well, in this picture, you see that you may have a couple of possibilities. You see, one possibility is that you think of F as a neural network, so you stay in machine learning, we say, in the primal space, and essentially what you do is that you learn neural networks to satisfy these constraints, you see? Because at the end of the day, these are functions that depend on weights, and then you have to learn neural networks which respect this kind of penalties. Or alternatively, you might use kernel machine, for example. So essentially, you work in the dual space, but you have parametric functions, and you know the learning problem is the one of discovering the parameters, right? Because you say that there is a parametric representation, and you say, well, I like a neural network representation. And particularly, since they are so fashionable nowadays, I like deep learning, okay? Deep architectures. Or you may like, kernel machines. Now, in the next few minutes, I want to tell you something about this choice. Once you become curious about, what learning is, and once you say that learning is constant satisfaction, okay, so the environment is forcing you to satisfy constraints, you may be curious to understand more about this issue. Why? Simply because here somebody is giving you, the neural network or a kernel machine. But you may be suspicious about this decision, right? Because you could say, well, in principle, it could be very nice if I could discover those functions here, from a functional point of view. I mean, I don't want to provide a sort of prior on the structure of these functions. I want to see what is the best function, and I want to study in a functional space. I want to pick up the solution, not from a neural network or from a kernel machine. I want to pick up the solution from the class of, functions that maybe belong to a Sobolev space, right? So from a mathematical point of view, it means that you are working in a much free space, right? You don't make so many commitments, so many assumptions. So, if you use this idea, I'll be very, quick on this concept, but I think it's nice to understand. So this is just to show, how the problem can be formulated. It can be formulated using variational principles. So what is parsimony? Parsimony, for everybody who is familiar with kernel machine, there is a classical way for expressing parsimony. But in this framework, we can do something similar. You could say, well, a parsimonious solution is one in which, what you see here is, look at this function, right? You introduce a sort of norm of this function. You say, that the norm is big, provided that the function, look at this picture, has a lot of peaks, right? A lot of variation. So the derivative here becomes pretty big, whereas if you look at the green function, you know, this is smooth. And it's just a way of measuring, you know, the regularity and you know, expressing the Occam razor principle, okay? Well, in general, this can be generalized. I want to be quick on this issue, but I wanted just to give you a few ideas about this study. I became curious of understanding, you know, what is the general solution. And there is a very interesting general solution that can be expressed. First of all, this is the formulation of the problem. You see, the formulation of learning can be expressed in a very clear way because you are looking for the solution. You see, F star is the solution, is the argument of the minimum of what? Of the norm of the function, provided that this function, you know, is respecting the constraints. So at the end of the day, the solution is I want to discover the best function which satisfies the constraints. And best means in terms of norm. So a smooth function, a smooth solution, once you give me a certain number of constraints. So let me show you what is the result. There is a, you know, the variational calculus offers you a nice perspective because it can tell you what is the solution. So let me show you the solution because for people who is familiar of kernel, on kernel machine, you know, there is some interesting result. And the result is that go directly to this expression, there is a sort of representation theorem which is very similar to the representation theorem of kernel machine. You see, the solution is the following one. The function, the unknown, can be expressed in this way. You see, G here is essentially a kernel. What is, you know, it's very similar to the kernel. And interestingly enough, this is a differential operator. So it is expressing the smoothness of the solution. So you see here the solution comes from the marriage of two terms. One is a kernel, which is telling you how smooth the solution is. And you see the other one is what I call the reaction of the constraint. And the reaction of the constraint can be computed, you know, from a general, you know, it's essentially a Lagrangian multiplier. For people who is familiar with Lagrangian multipliers, it's essentially a Lagrangian multiplier. The only point is that here the Lagrangian multiplier is in, you know, in a functional space. But if you look at what the reaction of the constraint is, you see the reaction of the constraint is proportional to the Lagrangian multiplier and to the gradient of the constraint. You see the gradient with respect to f of the constraint. So, you know, there is a theory for understanding what is the optimal solution, okay? Let me show you quickly that, for example, in the case of kernel machines, so for example, sorry, not in the case of kernel machine, the case of supervised learning, if you only are given constraints that are, Dirac delta, so essentially supervised constraints, the general representation theorem that I showed you becomes the representation theorem of kernel machine. So this means that, it's a message which is interesting because it's telling you that kernel machines is actually the best solution whenever you only interact with the protocol of supervised learning. There is nothing best once you accept the principle that you have to offer a solution in terms of regularization, okay? Of course, the problem, everybody who is familiar with kernel machine knows that the problem has to do with the choice of the kernel, right? Which means the degree of regularization that you want. But this is just to show you that the theory can be extended also to the case of constraints. Okay, so let me go quickly now to show a few examples of applications. So here is a list of problems that you have to that we consider it. But let me go quickly at least to select a few of them. Well, essentially, you see what we do. From a concrete point of view, we need to compute the reaction of the constraint. So the theory give you the you know, all the formalism, all the support for calculating the reaction of the constraint. In the case of kernel machine, you know, the reaction of the constraint can be computed in a very simple way. Once you have general constraints, well, it's more involved, but it can be done sometimes. So let me show you quickly an example, a couple of examples maybe. Well, this maybe it's interesting because maybe this picture is better for understanding. Yes, look at this. Suppose you are given a sort of Gaussian kernel, okay? And suppose that you want to learn a compset in an interval. So an interval means that instead of providing, let's say, a few examples, typical supervised protocol that you use in supervised learning, you want to impose that a certain function is active in an interval, right? So you know that it is active not on one point, right, but on an interval, okay? So which means that you know much more because you know some rule. Well, in this case, the theory suggests you that instead of using, this kind of kernel, instead of using this original Gaussian kernel, well, it tells you how to construct the appropriate kernel which exactly, you know, solve this problem. And, you know, these are good messages. So if you look at this picture, you can see the difference in some artificial experiment that we have done. You see here is with learning using only point. You see, we have two classes, red and blue, and you see the meaning of this rectangle is the following. We also know, in addition to the supervised points, that instead, so look at this. Inside this red rectangle, what we know is the category is red. And inside this blue rectangle, the category is blue, okay? So they are remarkable granule of information with respect to single points. So if you learn from point only, you get something like this. If you learn from boxes only, from only this rectangle, you get something like this. We can learn from point and box, and you get something like this. You know, the difference between these two pictures depend on the different regularization parameters. But just to tell you that, we can attack problems in which we are expressing constraints that are richer than single points. Here, you are saying that inside this rectangle, the category is red. Okay, so let me show you another example. This is completely different. It has to do with logic, essentially. Suppose you want to classify points, right? And you want to do something like this. You have two dimensions, okay? Two dimensions, and you have this category here, A, B, and C. So you see circle, and then you have triangle, and then you have this box, this box here, okay? So you see, and then of course you're given a collection of data and you want to make induction. Like, I want to know what is the category of this point here. Of course, you can use supervised learning in two dimensions, but suppose that you also know something more about this problem. And you know the following, rules. The rule is that whenever A and B is true, also C is true. You see, so you know also this formula. And you know also this other formula, A or B or C. What is the meaning? The meaning is that, look at the picture, if A and B are true, you see, A and B are true, you see what it means? A, this is A, this is A, this is B, okay, this is B. So A and B is just here, right? If A and B is true, also C is true. And C is all this box. Okay? So in a single formula, you are providing a lot of information. Okay? So in machine learning, we typically do something like this. You say, okay, this is a triangle. And the category is C. And this is a circle. The category is A. But here, by using a single formula, you are providing a lot of information. Because, you know, you are expressing a property which, you know, holds for infinite point. Okay? And look at another formula. For example, this one is telling you that A or B or C, which means that, you know, all the possibilities for the points is that, you know, they come in this either in A or in B or in C. There are no point here, there are no point here, right? So it's very important, you know, it's an important piece of information. So the theory make it possible to work jointly with points and this kind of, this kind of formula. So look at this picture. In this picture, you can see, how it works in terms of classification. Look at what happened, for example, if you use learning from example only, and what happened if you, on the opposite, use also logic. You see, this is class A, B, and C. You see the differences? Well, as you can imagine, they, of course, are remarkable simply because you are providing a lot of information that you don't have in this case. And, you know, this is typical in many other cases. Let me skip these slides. I think we can, yeah. Let me go quickly to show you something that I really like is the idea that once you learn from constraints, you can learn from constraints, but you can also check new constraint, new formula. Look, for example, this picture here. You have formula, okay? So you see this formula, and you may be interested in knowing something about possible deduction. For example, what you can try to understand is whether this formula here, A1 and A3 implies A2, if this formula is true. Okay? So this is typical in logic, right? You are given some premises and you want to see whether a certain conclusion is true. Okay? Typical in logic. Well, okay. What is the difference here? Well, look at a very important difference. The difference is that, we want to do something similar. Given this formula, we want to see whether, you know, this deduction, this conclusion can be drawn from these premises. But there is something new here, and I know that A1, A2, and A3, in this concrete problem, are not free to choose any value, okay? So in logic, all these variables here can take any Boolean value, okay? So this is one of the problems with logic, you know? Inferential problems in logic typically, are expensive from a computational point of view simply because you have an explosion in all possible, combination of variables. And you have to consider the Boolean hypercube in order to see whether a certain conclusion is true, okay? Now, look at what happened here. In this case, you know that just think about, A1, A2, and A3 as the categories of documents, right? Now, we are in touch with the environment. That's the big difference with the typical logic reasoning. You see? We are assuming that those categories, A1, A2, and A3, are not just abstract logic categories. They are strongly connected with the environment. I mean, these categories, can be induced also because these two variables, these two fixtures, X1 and X2. So in principle, the opposite way of reasoning with respect to logic is to use machine learning, right? In machine learning, supervised learning, you could say, please give me a collection of supervised points for A, for for A1, for A2, and for A3. You give me the supervised examples, and I will do my best for learning, you know, these categories. And of course, you know that there is the Carcel dimensionality. If you have a really challenging problem, well, Google doesn't help. And that's one interesting thing. Fortunately enough, you know, for us who are interested in this so beautiful field, science and nature is offering something that you know, cannot be attacked with the power of computers. I really like, you know, to see this involvement with big computational resources, but big computational resources are nothing with respect to most interesting problems that we see nowadays. This is not to, you know, to decrease the importance of, you know, all this emphasis on computational resources. Computational resources are just fantastic. But, you know, if you are dealing with some challenging problem, right, in which you have a huge collection of documents, in which you want to come up with a sort of semantic representation, in which you have huge collection of formula, well, that's the time in which deep learning doesn't help. That's the time in which, you know, all those in, computers doesn't help at all. And the reason is simple, because, you know, the space becomes so huge that it is simply impossible, you know, to come up with this kind of borders with the inferential mechanism of deep learning, at least in very, very challenging problems. Of course, it doesn't mean that, well, of course, it depends on the kind of problem that you are facing, but the same holds for logic. Even with logic, we know very well that if the number of variables, you know, are pretty big, well, you get in trouble because the inferential mechanism with logic, you know, are very heavy. Well, if you are interested in some inferential mechanism where, you know, yes, you are playing with logic, but you see the big difference is that those formula here are based on categories, you know, which are not randomly distributed, you know, are not making any possible choice of A1, A2, and A3. Because of the statistical distribution, right, those categories, you know, are quite related, and they have a sort of distribution. So from a pure logic point of view, we can easily see that this derivation is false. But if you want to see what happened in this environment, where, you know, there is a restriction on the domain, well, in this case, it is true, because whenever A1 and A3 are true, you see, whenever A1 and A3 are true, A2 is true as well, right? Whereas, if you make an interpretation, a pure logic interpretation, well, this is not true anymore. And I think this is very interesting because it is opening to a new way of performing inference, which is the inference in the environment. I mean, you are interested in making inference, but this time you don't want to explore the Boolean hypercube, because you are not interested in the Boolean hypercube, simply because you know in advance that most of those configurations will never happen in reality, simply because those data, you know, are still depending also on features. Okay, so let me, well, here is just a table to show that then we can perform, you know, experiment and you know, see with this mechanism which formula are true or false. But, you know, I want to conclude my talk in a few minutes with what I, at the end of this analysis, you know, which started maybe 5 years ago, and maybe more, you know, I think it's more interesting, at least to me. Well, let me tell you what I learned from this story. Well, I was, you know, quite happy about these results, but not so, you know, excited. I can tell you that at the end of the day, you know, those this theory, well, make it possible to find some beautiful, well, to understand some beautiful notion that you typically don't see when you learn from supervised example. There is this interesting challenge of getting in touch with logic, but let me tell you what is really not very satisfactory. Well, There is something which is not satisfactory to me, and is that, yeah, okay, this is satisfactory because examples are just constraints. This is satisfactory because, of course, there is no need to distinguish between perception and logic anymore. We can frame everything in the same theory, but there is something that I really don't like. And I can tell you that what I don't like is that we are missing the crucial role of time in learning. But before telling you that, well, you could say, why should be so important? Well, let me tell you something concrete. First of all, so far, I show you learning from constraint. What if you are also interested in learning constraints, right? So here, this point is completely missed. Because you, in this theory, you need somebody who provides constraints. But in many real problems, you don't even know what constraints are, okay? And even if you know the constraints, what I can tell you that is, at the end of the day, there is some remarkable problem in this approach. And the problem is that you can easily understand that once you start to involve complex constraints, those problems become, early very complicated in terms of optimization. And this is very nice, you know, because it seems that, from one side, the theory is clean, you can formulate everything, but the reverse of the coin is that, the optimization problem becomes very, very complex. And this is, of course, very bad and complex in my understanding, not because, with my resources. They become complex even with, remarkable resources, even with the Google resources. And so this is pretty bad because, I was wondering, what could be the reason for that? Because in a sense, right, even if the theory, I like the theory, is clean, but, it doesn't give you so much. Well, in a couple of slides, I want to tell you I think it's important and it's missing in this theory. What is really important is the crucial role of time. So I'm still in the context in which, I cancel the idea that there is supervised learning, there is unsupervised learning, semi-supervised learning. I say, well, I need another interaction with the environment, okay? But we are still in the same context in which we are assuming that somebody will, comes in front of the learning agent with a huge track of data, full of data, the track downloads the data, the agent takes all this, big amount of data and try and do its best for learning, right? In my understanding, there is something really wrong in this way of working. And I have the impression that it's really wrong. And we have to, as soon as possible, to escape this way of working. And the reason why, this is wrong, after years of this, formalism, at least it seems to me very clear. Because, from one side you get a beautiful theoretical picture of, how you can solve the problem. But, the reverse of the coin is that the problem is so complicated that you cannot solve the problem, at least at large scale. And my feeling is that we are really missing the time. And time, what is the meaning of missing the time? Well, the meaning, in case you want to read something, preliminary at least, there are a couple of papers that you can read in which, in this paper, we did our best for delivering and, the idea that learning should be very similar to, what happened in children, not because we intend to emulate, the biology of children, not because should be plausible from a cognitive point of view, but for another reason, from a computational point of view. And so we started to analyze the idea of learning like children, But learning, you know, to see like children is something that you can read in this paper, something in which we deliver a few preliminary ideas, and something in which you also see some of the preliminary ideas on what could be the meaning of learning by incorporating the time, is in this paper which appeared last year in Theoretical Computer Science, which is based on a sort of interpretation of learning as something that has to obey, let's say, laws of computation. So essentially, in this paper, what we try to do is to formulate learning just as a sort of law of nature in which time really plays its own role. And instead of, you know, taking the challenge of learning from a huge collection of data, you start thinking that maybe it's much better if your agent start living in the environment and you provide some clever mechanism for adapting continuously to the environment. In a sense, you know, you could say nothing new, because online learning is something that we, you know, has already been considered for years and years. But if you start thinking carefully about what online learning is in most cases, you will realize that online learning is simply a sort of, let's say, alternative interpretation of batch mode learning. Looks like the ideal model, the theoretically correct model for many people, is batch mode learning, right? So the idea that you learn from a huge collection of data, and then if you want to perform a good approximation, then you have online learning. Please consider that you don't be confused. This is not involving time in the learning process. It's something different. You are simply using a different, you know, iteration mechanism for learning, but it's not involving time in the mechanism of learning. So essentially, what we need to do is to attack what I call the egg-chicken dilemma in many machine learning problems. Vision is for sure one interesting example. Natural language processing is another example. You know, and it seems to me that the only way for breaking this problem is to have the possibility of agents which perform a sort of developmental learning, right, day by day, starting from scratch, just like children. And this, in my understanding, is not a matter of you know, emulating children. It's not a matter of biology. On the opposite, I do believe that it's a computational issue to which biology has to obey as well. So this is the last slide. And the last slide is that, you know, is making the suggestion that we can escape this egg-chicken dilemma exactly by developmental learning. And, you know, cognitive laws, in my understanding, can be discovered just, you know, while living. And, you know, the constraints can be learned. That's the principle. I would like to learn the constraint, just like the task, okay, at the same time. So if you look at this equation, you know, in this talk, I did my best to convince you that we can learn once the constraints are given, right? And then once the constraints are given, we have a new protocol for learning function f, right? Now, what if we learn all together constraints and function f? In my understanding, you know, once we start to understand what is the meaning of learning, also the constraint, well, we should be close to something much more interesting. But of course, what we need is written here in red, is that we need new representations of the parsimony principle. So for example, what is a beautiful formula here? What is a beautiful constraint? So how should I make suggestions about what is a good constraint? Okay, so thanks a lot for your attention.
Thanks, Marco. Thanks, Marco. We have time for questions. I will grab another microphone. And since we're recording this, it would be great if you can ask your questions into a microphone. So, any questions?
Yeah, thanks. I have a question for the last part that it's you talked about natural learning involves time. It's really interesting that until now something that humans are good at and machine learning still struggles is to completely change the learning or the strategy that he applied until now for a new example. So I don't know, we see a game, we apply a certain strategy to play, and then a machine repeats that. But if we see another player that plays differently and wins much more easily, we quickly adapt and change our strategy too. And maybe learning from constraints in this can give an advantage, adding some constraints on the spot, or it differs?
Yeah, okay. Well, the case of you know, in which an agent, for example, is involved in a game, and what you said concerning the adaptation to new strategies, for example, simply because you see that somebody is capable of is offering a better strategy, is from one side, it's true that when I told you I was excited about the possibility of the theory of attacking more or less any problem, yeah, this is true. But if you just consider your example, it's exactly one example in which you see that the learning mechanism, in many cases, do rely on also on a sort of temporal structure. So, to be honest, at the moment, you know, a complex problem cannot be attacked by this theory. And in problems like the one you are mentioning, in which you are considering very sophisticated human strategies, in which you see, people observing the evolution of strategies, and they can pick up the most appropriate strategies, is just an example, in any case, of the importance of, learning in the environment. And there is no possibility, I think, of replacing this with what we have done so far in machine learning, which is essentially, regardless of, how big your computational resources are, to use still the same uniform idea. In computer vision, ImageNet, I guess there are a number of people who know what ImageNet is something great, very big actually. But could you say that ImageNet is meaningful in terms of vision? Well, I honestly believe that it's not. Is nothing with respect to the complexity of information that we have in vision. And I think that there is no benchmark, no data set, which can somehow model properly what vision is. And the same for language. And the example that you pose is one in which you see, how important, on the opposite, is the way we humans experiment of learning, which is in no way is a sort of collection, huge collection of data that you start to process without any developmental idea. And so my final comment is, what if sometimes I'm puzzled about what happened, for example, in vision, right? And not only in vision, in many problem or cognition. Nature seems to do something interesting. Like, for example, in vision is very well known that children in the early stage of life, they have a sort of blurring of the image, right? You may wonder that this is a sort of biological solution, right? But I do believe that you know, there is one of the secrets of solution for vision, and maybe in language there are something similar, there are similar solutions. So the information flooding, the huge amount of data that we have with our machine learning algorithms is part of the problem. We are offering, we computer scientists are offering machine a problem which is much more difficult that can be offered in nature. When I say it's much more difficult, I say that we construct a huge training set and we say, okay, now you have to learn from this huge training set. Whereas for humans, the task, the kind of target that humans have is not exactly the target that we expect the machine to have. So nobody is expecting, suppose there is a boy of, let's say, 10 years old and comes and start understanding this talk, okay? Nature is fantastic from this point of view because, a very smart boy will stay here for, my guess is, 30 seconds, maybe 1 minute. And this is great. It is what is saving his time and his computational capabilities. Suppose you are forcing the boy to stay here, just like we are forcing our learning algorithm to drink this huge collection of data. That's a problem. And that's where the problem in machine learning is. That's my failure in the last 5 years, I think.
So I have a question. I didn't understand the last two sentences. What is your failure?
Three sentences?
I didn't understand the very end where you said this is what my failure is.
Actually, at the end, the theory of learning from constraint is still based on the idea that you give me data, right? Well, it's not supervised learning. And that's beautiful. I like this. It's not supervised learning because if you have to satisfy a constraint, in a very simple example, suppose that the constraint is based on two functions, right? And you are imposing that the sum of this function is equal to 2, right? Well, even if you don't have any supervision, that's a beautiful constraint. It's a beautiful penalty because you are imposing, you take your data, your huge collection of data, and you try to enforce the constraint, right? And this is what I've done with huge collection of data. So this is beautiful from one side, but the problem is still the one connected to his question and to many very challenging machine learning tasks. The problem is that we need an approach which naturally incorporates time, the way we learn, but not because I want to emulate humans, simply because I'm confident that from a pure computational point of view, it is the only possibility of attacking complex problems. As I said, in vision, for example, the reason why nature is blurring, in my understanding, is to say from information flooding, right? Because it's like the boy the boy I was thinking about, is saving his time because it has a beautiful focus and attention mechanism. Maybe he's curious, but after a few seconds, 30 seconds, will escape this room. And this is important for any learning system.
Thanks.
I hope you don't mind, but could you go back to the example of the three classes that you were talking about, where you try to learn the inference or you evaluated those inferences?
Oh, so let me help you to understand for inferences.
Slide. Yes, that's one.
Okay.
What I understand here is you looped through all the possible combinations of constraints to try to learn them and evaluated their probability of success over here. Is that right?
Well, essentially what we try, these are candidate constraints, right? So it's like to say you learn from a certain collection of formula, and then what you do later on is that you want to see whether they are true. For example, this is the knowledge base. Okay, so these three formulas are given. Okay, so you are given this one, and this one. Okay, and then what you want to do is that you want to establish whether, you know, the remaining formula are true. Right. And so how can you check? Actually, I didn't say how this can be done. And maybe it's also part of the question, but this can be done simply because suppose you take this formula here, this is translated into a real value constraint, and then what you have is a sort of penalty, and you can take the penalty and accumulate the error over the training set, okay? Well, now, of course, this is expensive because you have to make all the accumulation over all the training set, or your data, but please consider that if you compare with problem of typical problem of automatic reasoning in which you have the typical exponential explosion, here you don't have any exponential explosion, okay? And simply because you may need to process a huge training set, but it's not exponential, right? And of course, this is not as strong as logic in the sense of formal logic, because in formal logic you end up with a decision, and you say that this formula is true or false, right? Regardless of the fact that you are in a certain environment. Remember, the environment is important because it is somehow restricting, the decision on the Boolean hypercube. Instead of considering all the combination, the environment is dramatically cutting, the space, the decision space. It's a sort of manifold. If you think in terms of the real function, it's a manifold. So instead of being in a huge dimensional space, the decision is on the manifold. And of course, this is the big advantage, and of course, it's not as strong as formal reasoning, because it's only a sort of approximate reasoning exactly in that environment. But I don't know whether I got your point, but I think it was... Did I?
Yeah, that answers part of my question.
Okay.
The other part was, I wanted to know if there was... This was what you considered for a very small set of constraints.
Yeah.
But what if we had a much larger set? Is that what you meant by a difference between the exponential explosion?
Okay, well... What is interesting here is that just consider, for example, the growth of the number of literals, okay? Well, once you have the growth of literals in logic, it's bad, okay? You get in trouble. Here, in principle, you don't get in trouble because of this problem, simply because, what is important here is that, is the dimension, how big is the space, the perceptual space. So in a sense, this is a decision which is grounded to the perceptual space. So it depends on how big the perceptual space is. But interestingly enough, the perceptual space has to do with life, humans and also machine. So my understanding is that many of the decisions, many of the cognitive mechanisms that we activate, are dominated from the complexity point of view, because we don't need to consider all the possibility of the Boolean hypercube. And if you are in a sort of manifold, you may have also a huge number of variables here, right? Suppose you have 100 variables, right? Which is still a pretty big number for logic. And here, it depends a lot, on how big is the perceptual space. So the space of your data, which typically is finite. Of course, it could be expensive, but from a complexity point of view, there is a completely different way of dealing with this reasoning mechanism. Of course, they are not comparable because they are approximate and they can fail from the formal logic point of view. But remember, in this picture, the failure was appreciated. I mean, if you look at this formula here, this is not, this conclusion here cannot be derived from these three premises, from a pure logic point of view. But interestingly enough, here, you can draw this conclusion. So, you know, it is not as good as formal logic because in the formal logic point of view, but you may desire to have this kind of reasoning mechanism.
Any other questions?
Hey, so first, thank you for your talk. I can tell you that coming from the constraint community, it was really deeply interesting. I will have a question about learning constraints. I don't know if you're familiar with the notion of global constraints in constraint programming. Depending on your answer, I explain a bit or not what it is. So, yeah, okay. And actually, when you said that you're looking to learn constraints, I was wondering if it is somehow you try to learn a kind of global constraint, not the same global constraints as not the same definition in constraint programming, but somehow maybe you are looking to learn to recognize kind of a recurrent constraint, something that appears often to model problems, to model your kernel problems. So I was wondering if there is a kind of connection between this kind of global constraints and learning constraints, the way you are trying to do.
Yeah, well, okay, so thanks for the question, because first of all, I have to tell you that I knew a little bit of the of the literature in constraint programming because of, a number of, a lot of time spent with people in our country. I don't know whether you know Francesca Rossi. So with Francesca, I tried to learn something from Francesca from this point of view, because so I know a little bit about constraint programming. I can tell you honestly that at the moment I don't have a clear picture on how this huge experience in the field could be used, because I'm confident that it's only a matter of ignorance, because there is a huge literature in constraint programming, and of course the language in most cases is so different that you need, as usual, to be patient and you need to talk. But I have the impression that that's a sort of, it could be a very interesting marriage, to be more patient and trying to understand how many of, because of course many of the things on, on learning constraints, learning of constraints are definitely an important topic in that community. Now, you've probably got one specific issue here, is that at the same time, we have to learn also what I call the task, right, which are those functions, which typically, and that's one remarkable difference with respect to what people maybe like you and Francesca Rossi are doing, typically you play more with symbolic, only with symbolic stuff. At least for what I know, in most cases. Here, there is also the need of expressing these functions, typically by models like neural networks or kernel machine, because there is also a perceptual space. Okay, there is also a perceptual space, but I think you're right, many of the problems, especially on learning the constraints, could be similar. At the moment, when I concluded my talk, I invoked this idea. So the idea that you should look for some formula which is simple enough, and I'm confident that this is nothing new, but we have to introduce some nice idea of what a formula, for example, a logic formula, when the formula is simple, because you may have, many First of all, you could say that if you want to learn constraints, one problem is the structure of constraint, whether suppose they are Horn clauses or maybe some more complex formula, right? And then you have also to express a sort of a degree of simplicity, because otherwise, you know, maybe the solution is not very effective. But I confess this is really something that in which I have to learn concerning that community.
Thank you.
Hi. Going back to the boy who was not very here, but rarely here, I think it's pretty interesting that you said he stays only a minute because there is a limit to the curiosity he had. It's boring for him because he can't understand the subject, and even if he tried, he can't. There is no value for him. And have you thinking about how can we translate the concept of curiosity in terms of learning for machine?
Sorry, I can translate the concept of what?
The concept of curiosity.
Ah, curiosity. Okay. Into okay. In terms of learning of constraints.
Not especially for constraint, but just learning,
yes,
for a machine.
Learning something. Yes.
In yeah. Finding a function, yeah, or something to minimize that is something that is.
Yeah, yeah. Well, that's of course a very challenging issue, and we all know that curiosity is, at least in humans, is probably the most important things for learning. And I confess that at the moment I don't have any clear or any idea of what really curiosity could be. But curiosity, if you really can find some formal description, I'm confident that could be important. For example, in my framework, could be for for extracting the constraint. Well, I can tell you a few things in any case. Remember my example of the boy who entered the room, start to listen what we are talking about, and after a few minutes, leave the room. This is not an example of a very pertinent and specific example of what curiosity means, because it's more a sort of focus of attention, right, in that case. The boy is smart enough to understand that he's losing his time. So it's something which is somehow saving his time, and it is not exactly curiosity means, which could be a little bit more specific and also subtle, because you need really to have a mechanism which is a positive mechanism more than a sort of rejection, right? The boy says, okay, I want to exit because I'm not interested anymore. Whereas curiosity is a sort of more creative step in which you select something because you find it very interesting. And maybe we can also try to think about this possibility. But I'm confident. Only a comment about this. I'm confident I know more or less like anybody here about this possibility. But I think they are extremely important. They are part, you know, what you say concerning curiosity or other specific social human behavior. I want to reinforce the idea that, in my understanding, they are not just something that has to do with biology. They are important for learning quickly, no matter what, you know, the body of the learning agent is. But I don't have any
Yeah. I kind of like the question, and I also like your the beginning of your answer when you said, you know, what is the definition of curiosity here? It's certainly very important for learning, and I think, you know, this your example of this little guy coming into the room and not understanding anything of what you're talking about, he concludes after a minute or so that, you know, I mean, I might go out as well out again and do something more useful with my time. And so the question really is, as you said, you know, what is the definition of curiosity? And I think there are two terms somewhere in there. One is, okay, I don't know, because if I only knew, I don't have to be curious about it because I already know. But on the other side, there's a term that has to describe somehow that I already know something about it, because otherwise I don't have anything to attach it to. So you know, there is no point in being curious about something that I have no idea about. I have nothing where I can start to kind of attach new things to it. So I need, in this conceptual space somewhere, you know, on the cognitive side of things there in this pyramid, I need to have something to attach stuff to. And if I don't, then there's no point in being curious. This is what I understand from what you said. And I think this is very interesting. So, you know, the curiosity is not only the lack of understanding, it's also, there's an obligation to have something to attach it to.
So I'd like to say that is the state in which you, of course, you're somehow aware of a notion that could be extremely important for you, and then you can grasp if you are patient enough, because that's important. But it is extremely difficult, you know, to identify what is really important for you, and whether, you know, it is not like the case of the boy who has to leave the room. Because, as you said, maybe you realize that you are not far away from the concept, and then you can grasp something really useful.
Okay, there's another question.
I would thank you for your presentation. I just have one question about learning of constraints. So how do you deal with the perturbations in the data if you have? That means if you have a huge number of data, how do you recognize the incorrect learned constraints and correct ones?
Okay, so in order, it's important that when I reply to this question, it's also important for all of you to know that maybe you got from what I said, this is really preliminary investigation, right? So while I've done some research in learning from constraints, learning of constraint at the moment is only something that I've explored, but not with the same, you know, with the same effort. You know, what you are saying concerning perturbation and only, the typical tricky learning environments in which we human are involved, it's very interesting because we can, in many cases, deal quite easily with information which, in principle, seems to deliver opposite conclusions, right? And after a while, we realize, you know, what is the right direction. And, you know, this is a very complex human mechanism and generally computational mechanism, you know, to understand that you have this information which during your life, you know, changes because your data maybe are not compatible and they are expressing something which, you know, support different conclusions. I'm confident in any case that this mechanism in which you have also perturbation of data, something which is not coherent, you know, these are the idea of learning in the environment, so while living, instead of so conceiving mechanism that, as I said, does involve time, but time, not the iteration of the algorithm. which is really different. Please believe me, it's really another story. The iteration, just think about backprop, right? Something like online backprop. It is something which has nothing to do with time, with something like, you know, I have my experience in the life, I have some experience, and then, you know, something changes, as you said, and I have to adapt to something which changes. You know, it could be apparently, you know, the models of online learning are somehow in that direction, but I'm confident that it's not that direction. And at the moment, you know, I don't have really answer to questions like this. What we did was, you know, if you like, you may have a look. Maybe you could be interested in this paper. In this paper, you know, there is an attempt, at, you know, very general to think about cognition as something which emerges from laws of nature, just like, you know, quantum mechanics or, you know, something with the same idea. And the idea is that there is time. This time there is also, there are potentials, like in physics, right? And what are potentials here? Are the environmental constraints? Because during living, you know, these agents have to interact, right? And so there is really time, and there is a sort of potential, just like in physics. And then you have also something similar to, you know, for example, in mechanics, kinetic energy, because it has to do with regularity, with smoothness. And, you know, it is a mechanism, if you start thinking in this way, you really try to enforce constraints during the living, And we have in this case time, but please consider that you know, this is just a sort of very preliminary study, and maybe many people have been doing something similar, and it's just an attempt to you know, change dramatically the way in which learning is you know, is formulated. Exactly, because I believe, as I said, that it is not the right formulation.
But
I don't have the right formulation, for sure.
a rough linear regression says that, well, we might have time for another question, we don't have time for another answer. So let's thank Marco again for his presentation.
Okay. Thanks to all of you for, you know, so many questions. Thanks.
Is there a software implementation of any of this? A GitHub repository,
yes.
A Hello just in World case, example?
Yeah.
So we'll email it around for everybody so that we don't have to memorize things today.
Yeah. Well, of course, I'll be pleased. People who is interested in any, well, you can be in touch with me. That's probably the most efficient way. You drop an email, I'll be extremely pleased to talk with you. That's probably the most straightforward way. Yeah, for the software, we have a package, a software package for doing, you know, this learning from constraint. And but if you you can go there just from my web page. Because not from my web page. It's too difficult. Type learning from constraint.
I'm going to ask
Google.
You for a copy of the slides, and I will email them to
yeah,
everybody.
Yeah, sure.
And that way, we'll all have this.
Okay.
That will be great. Thanks. So, just a reminder that we'll have a little bit of. Bon, je vais parler français quand même. Donc, il y a un petit goûter en bas après. Pour ceux qui connaissent le lieu, c'est évident, mais pour ceux qui ne connaissent pas, il y a un escalier juste à l'extérieur, vous descendez au rez-de-chaussée et c'est juste là. Pour la semaine prochaine, lundi prochain, il y aura encore une présentation du Nantes Machine Learning Meetup. Ce sera Eric Le Carpentier et Yannick Austin de l'École Centrale qui vont parler d'une main robotique et ce qu'ils ont fait avec. Donc voilà. Et je vous remercie. Pour les étudiants d'Epitech, Merci d'être venu. Je voudrais juste vous dire que la présentation de Marco était parmi les plus techniques que nous avons vues. C'était super, j'en étais très content. Mais ne vous désespérez pas si vous n'avez pas compris le tout, parce que c'était quand même assez, assez poussé. Voilà. Donc, merci à tous.